Good morning and welcome to the last day of this workshop. As mentioned, I'll be discussing in the first session a different way of introducing the concept of programming. This approach assumes that there would be several people who would not know anything about computers. It assumes that there will be many others who would have seen and used computers, but mainly for browsing or such thing. And of course, there will be some who would have learned some programming before coming to our courses. In the very first lecture, contrary to what Professor Ranaday said, we should actually not talk about computers, but we should restate the importance of procedures and instructions and how the ability to write such instructions so that they can be followed easily by others is the very basis of writing computer programs. But let me describe what I mean by procedures and instructions. The first one is very easy for us to tell people, that many of our activities require a step-by-step procedure to be followed. Now, some simple instructions are of course given verbally. Consider the following. I'm thirsty. There is someone in the house. I'll simply say, please get me a glass of water. Now, since that person is in the house, from the house, I don't have to tell that person where the glasses are, where the drinking water is. I expect the person to go, locate a glass, fill it up with drinking water, and bring it to me. So although this is the step-by-step procedure which that person has followed, it was not required for me to elaborate that procedure. Most instances in our life where we request someone to do something are often handled through such verbal instructions. Consider another instruction. Please keep the book on shelf. Again, we assume a lot of context. For example, we assume that the person will take the book and will not keep it on a shelf where shoes are kept, but will keep it in a shelf where books are kept. We presume that much of intelligence, that much of knowledge, and that much of context from the person who is executing our instruction. But there are occasions when certain instructions are to be executed by a large number of people who are not able to see us or listen to us. For them, a written instruction is essential. In most situations, the jobs or tasks which they are required to do need several steps to be listed in our instructions. And that is why such procedures are often available as written or printed documents which contain specific instructions to be followed. Consider these examples. Directions to a place. Of course, in India, we still depend upon the verbal directions. And even if somebody gives us an elaborate direction, on the way, it is not uncommon to go and ask someone, reconfirming whatever someone else had told us. But in general, it is a methodical practice to get written instructions giving us directions to a place. You'll be familiar with recipes. I will tell you about one example from WikiHow site. But these recipes are listed. Now note that people who are habitual cooks, expert cooks, such as our mothers, sisters at home, they don't follow recipe book while cooking a lunch or dinner for us. But still you have recipe books. Why? Because something unfamiliar, something less known, if someone wants to try, and someone wants to try it with some precision, then written instructions are required. User manuals is another example of written instructions. Instructions given to us by a bank to fill up an account opening form will be one such instruction. Consider this recipe, preparing Indian chai. Now, instructions to make chai can be written as, take water in a pan, add tea leaves and sugar, heat the water, maybe add basil leaves and ginger flakes, add milk and boil. Once the water boils, filter out the solids and serve in a cup or glass with biscuits. This, by the way, I have not constructed it. It is a recipe for chai from WikiHow. All of you will be familiar with Wikipedia. WikiHow is another site which publishes open source contents on how to do things. That is, of course, a pictorial recipe that is given there. Those of you who are interested can look it up. I would also like to mention again the notion of context. For most of us in India, this is a very stupid recipe. All of us know it. In fact, there are differences in making chai in India, in North India, West India, South India, the chai is made differently. But still, more or less, this preparation is well known. But if you go to developed countries where tea is often made by taking a cup of boiling water and putting inside it a sachet of tea leaves. And in fact, there are many who know or who think or who believe that that's the only way to make tea. So obviously, if you ask anyone to make Indian chai, they would just not understand this procedure unless it is written down and made available to them. An important aspect of showing such procedures is also to emphasize that the sequence in those steps is important. For example, if I execute the filter out solid steps before adding milk and boiling, please note, I have taken water in a pan, I have added tea leaves and sugar, I have heated the water, I have added basil leaves and ginger flakes, and suppose at this stage I say filter out the solids and then add milk and boil. Well, the tea will not at all taste like an Indian chai, and there are such small nuances which we can use to tell people that although there are some steps which can be interchanged, but generally, a procedure must follow the steps in sequence. For those steps which can be exchanged or interchanged, the end result does not change even if we write them in a different manner. However, once we write those instructions, then those instructions better be followed in the given sequence. When we say this, what are we doing? We are actually emphasizing a future fact to our students that the instructions written on our program will be executed sequentially, exactly in the given order and no other way. Here is an exercise to write instructions to fill up a bucket with sand for firefighting. Many of us would have seen such buckets. They are hanging outside many buildings and so on. Now, I have written here the simplest instruction. An instruction given to someone will be, fill up the bucket with sand. But consider this, the person whom we are telling to fill up this bucket with sand may not know where sand is. Even if he knows that there is a sand dump somewhere nearby, he may not know how to bring that sand and fill it up in the bucket. So you might have to tell him, get a tagari, get a fawda, carry this there. Then he will ask you, where do I find tagari and fawda? So we tell him that there is a room which has garden implements. Go there, pick up this, go to that sand dump, pick up sand and bring it and then fill this up. Now, you see, a whole lot depends upon what we assume the person to know before deciding what level of granularity of instructions are required. Again, we can explain this through several examples. There are some pictorial animations that are associated with this. I'll show you one, because on AVU it's not easy to do that. Maybe within a few days I will edit them and put them up into YouTube so that you can all see that later. I have one video on YouTube which I'll show you, but it is not related to this this part of the introduction. Having told them about procedures, we would like to introduce them to computers. In my opinion, it is better to show some intermediate complexity, machine-like thing, but which actually can behave like a computer and has implements which resemble the operational features of a computer. So here is the caricature we have made. We have a team of animators here led by Mr. Samir Sastrabuddhe. That team has actually made these animations. This one is a still image of what we call Mr. Buddhuram Dumbo. Mr. Dumbo, the Buddhuram name, all of you, at least those who know Hindi, will relate to. Buddhuram really stands for a person who is actually dumb-witted, not dumb, dumb-witted. And that is why I have titled his name as Buddhuram and his surname as Dumbo, so that English speaking people can also understand what I mean. This caricature is described to have the ability to do certain predefined functions well, provided we give instructions to him at every stage. We then introduce the additional implements or tools that Mr. Dumbo has for doing his work. Remember, at this stage we are trying to tell people that we'll introduce a simplified model of a computer to you. So we are actually trying to describe what a computer has and how through programs the computer can be made to do our bidding. We are of course talking about handling numerical values, adding them, subtracting them, multiplying them, doing simple processing. Now let's roll back and see what exactly does a computer have in terms of our ability to get it to process our numbers and other information. First, it has a memory. So we talk about memory locations and so on, and the internal representation using binary numbers, whatever. It has an internal arithmetic and logic unit, which essentially consists of several registers and circuitry to perform those operations. It is my observation that when you try to tell this in a standard way, many times the people are unable to form a mental model of the computer. So in this case, we give a workbench to Mr. Dumbo, and we tell people that Mr. Dumbo is able to use registers kept on the workbench. It can get values from its memory and do some calculation. What is the memory? Well, I have fashioned a some kind of cupboard with drawers. Each drawer contains one value. I have found that that is a good enough explanation. For input-output, I have given Dumbo a cart. So let us look at some of his implements. This is Mr. Buddhuram. Buddhuram has a shelf which contains drawers. I tell students that each drawer can be labeled. We can tell the label, and Buddhuram will attach a label to any number of drawers which we wish to use. We tell students that each drawer contains one value, exactly one value, no less and no more. So this is our representation of computer's memory. As I told you, we give a hand cart, a cart typically in which people carry luggage. In this case, Mr. Dumbo uses this cart to carry numbers. You can vaguely see number 5 here. This cart is used by Dumbo for input as well as output. Later on we'll see an animation where a input operation is performed and output operation is performed, etc., etc., by Mr. Buddhuram. Here is the workbench that we have given. Much like we will sit on a table with papers in our hand, and on those papers we can do some computations. In exactly similar way, we expect Mr. Dumbo to do the computations that we ask him to do using what we call registers. We tell students that register is almost like a piece of paper in one's hand in which values can be written and operations on these numbers can be performed. This then is the crux of our simplified model of telling people about Buddhuram Dumbo. Here Dumbo is shown that there was a value 20 in a cupboard drawer called height, and Dumbo has just picked up that value 20, copied it onto the register. Notice that we can actually demonstrate that when Dumbo transfers something to the workbench, that something still remains in the memory. In fact, we have to emphasize that the input operation is the only operation which can destroy the contents of memory, and an assignment operation is the only other operation which can destroy the original contents of the memory. Now this we emphasize later when we talk about programs, but using this simple model, it's actually possible to easily get into the minds of students and help them build a mental model. So they now understand memory as a set of locations which are like drawers, each drawer contains some value. Whenever we say input or output, they can imagine a cart, Mr. Dumbo carrying values from us to the cart and carries values back to us in the cart from the drawers. I will now show you some small animations. So this is an introduction animation. This shows the set of drawers in a cupboard. We can tell people that the drawers can be named so that each drawer is uniquely identified. We can show that a drawer can be opened, Dumbo can inspect a value. We can say that a question mark actually means that we do not know in advance what the value is. So these then, and here is a card where Dumbo is actually bringing a value in. Well, these are the basic components that Dumbo uses to carry out things. Let us consider an input activity that Dumbo will execute. Let's say we show that we want to add two numbers A and B, and we want to give input to A and B. Here is an input operation where Dumbo brings a value in, opens the drawer for A. There is some value inside, he doesn't care. He then picks out the value which he has brought in this particular case, the number 8. He picks it up and keeps it inside that drawer. Observe that when he keeps it inside the drawer, the previous question mark disappears. This we used to tell people that an input operation is destructive in the sense that old value in the memory is displaced by the new value. In this fashion, another number will come. This may be for location B, and the Dumbo will do exactly the same thing. It will open the drawer for B, examine whatever it is, take the value from the cart which he has just brought from us and put it inside the location for B. So this illustrates an input operation. Let us consider an operation of adding two values. So here are two values shown. A contains 35. B contains 12, and we have asked Buddhuram Dumbo to add these two values to calculate a sum. The location for sum is available, but the value inside is not known to us at this juncture. So look at what Dumbo does. Dumbo will open the drawer A, take a copy of a number, observe that a number still continues to reside in A, and put it in one of the registers. Next, Dumbo will take the second value and put it in another register. So on the workbench, he has two registers. He has collected two values to be added. And now Mr. Buddhuram will actually add these two values, 12 plus 35, getting the result 47 in a third register. So registers are like pieces of paper on which Dumbo writes. Finally, Dumbo will take this value 47 and keep it inside the location for sum. Notice now that A, B and C, A, B and sum contain the appropriate values here. Having calculated the sum of A and B, we would like Dumbo to give us back the calculated output. So here is a small video showing how the output instruction will work. Dumbo will open the drawer for sum, will take a copy of the number which is inside sum and put it in the card. Notice that the location sum or the drawer sum continues to contain the same value. An output operation therefore does not destroy the whole value. Finally, Dumbo will simply bring this card back to us. Observe that such an animation can be extremely useful if we back it up by saying that now that Dumbo can do these things, how can we give instructions to Dumbo to actually carry out these operations? So let us get back to our slide. Here is our friend Buddhuram. He can do certain basic things which we have just seen. To do those basic operations, Buddhuram has a cupboard in which there are drawers. Each drawer can hold only one value at a time. These drawers can be named by us. We can tell Dumbo, call a drawer A, call a drawer roll, call a drawer height, or whatever we wish. Next, Mr. Dumbo has a cart which he uses to ferry values back and forth. So he can carry an input value given by us and put it in the designated drawers, or he can take a copy of a value from a designated drawer and bring it back to us. This explains the capability of Buddhuram as a capability to do input-output operation. We then explain that there is something called a workbench, and using this workbench, our friend Buddhuram is able to do computations involving values which are stored in these drawers. The question is, how do we exploit these capabilities, and in what fashion do we tell Mr. Dumbo to do some precise operations so that we can get desirable results? So I will demonstrate a sort of simple programming construct that I have created for Mr. Dumbo. We want to write a program or instructions. First of all, we want Mr. Dumbo to take two values from us. We design an instruction called input. Since we want Mr. Dumbo to take two values from us, we want Dumbo to keep them in two different drawers. We have to name the drawers, so we choose the name, let's say A and B. Of course, Dumbo will say, you never told me that these are the names which you are going to use. So we will give another instruction to Mr. Dumbo before this, which will say, use locations A and B. We know, of course, that Dumbo will also be required to use another location to keep the calculated sum. So we might as well describe that here. So note that the first instruction which we give to Mr. Dumbo is not actually an instruction requiring an action, but it requires Dumbo to affix labels to three of the drawers in the cupboard. So when we say use locations A, B, sum, Mr. Dumbo will just affix these labels to the three locations. Now the action will start when Dumbo starts executing our instructions written below. The first instruction says input A, B. We know what exactly Dumbo will do. It will come to us twice using his cart. It will collect one value from us put it in the location for A. It will collect another value from us, put it in the location for B, or put it in the drawer for B. Our next instruction will be calculate sum as the addition of A and B. Note that we are actually using the pretext of instructing Mr. Dumbo to actually learn some very simple syntax rules of a programming language that we are going to later on describe, but without calling this a programming language. We are trying to keep it very simple, very similar to English-like instructions that we have seen earlier, but instructions given very precisely to this artificial artifact called Mr. Dumbo. Now, having said sum is equal to A plus B, we now know exactly, having seen the basic capability of Mr. Dumbo, what Dumbo will do. It will take the value of A from the drawer A, bring it to the register of his workbench, again bring the value for B, add these two values, calculate a third result, and this result Mr. Dumbo will deposit in the drawer for sum. Having done this, we want to tell Mr. Dumbo to bring that value to us. So we may fashion an instruction called output. And we know, having seen Mr. Dumbo's basic capability of input and output, that when we tell him to output sum, he will actually go to the drawer called sum, pick out a copy of the value, keep it in the cart, and bring that cart back to us. In fact, I usually play a composite animation at this stage describing the execution of these instructions. I also introduce a notion at this stage to say that, look, we have written these instructions for Mr. Dumbo as plain sentences. But in English, whenever a sentence ends, we put a full stop or some punctuation mark. Well, because these are instructions to be executed one after another, they are all related to each other, they can be regarded as some kind of components of a single large instruction, and they can therefore be separated by a semicolon rather than a full stop. Notice that, and at least this is what I have discovered using this model for last 2 or 3 years to teach CS 101, that students are very easily able to imagine in their minds that a memory has locations, each of which has a name. Second, the memory contains a value. A value gets destroyed if it contains something, if there is an input operation and a new value comes in, or it gets destroyed whenever Dumbo keeps a value inside it after calculating something. So essentially an old value disappears only when Dumbo keeps something inside it or not, otherwise the old value remains. Students are able to picturize through the caricature of the Dumbo carrying that hand cart the input and output operation. Namely, some value is given by us as input, Dumbo will carry it. So the moment we say input A, people can imagine that Dumbo is coming to us and waiting for us. The moment we give a value, Dumbo will carry that value and put it in the designated drawer. Similarly, when we say output sum, Dumbo will open the drawer for sum, make a copy of the value there, put it inside the cart and bring it to us. Usually, after this, they are able to follow the basic operations of a computer without understanding that the computer actually behaves like that. Let us go back to the slides. This is a program written from Mr. Buddhuram, which I just showed. The word Dumbo there is just to say that the program is for Mr. Dumbo. It is actually addressing Mr. Dumbo. It is saying, Mr. Dumbo, please do the following. Use locations A, B, and sum. Input two values A and B. Calculate the sum A plus B and put it in the drawer titled sum, and then output the value contained in that drawer. Notice what we have achieved. We have actually achieved that our students now understand the notion of a set of instructions written step by step meant for doing some computational work. Our students now have a mental picture in their mind about memory locations, each location containing exactly one value, about an input-output operation where values can come from outside and go inside. They have a mental model of how calculations are performed when Mr. Dumbo, in response to executing an instruction called sum is equal to A plus B, actually goes to those memory drawers, make copies of two values and brings them onto the workbench, keeps them in register, calculates the total and deposits the total in a location or in a drawer called sum. Without emphasizing things too much, we have subtly introduced the notion that a memory drawer can contain only one value at a time, that the value inside the memory drawer remains, even if I say output that value, the value does not come out and go, but only a copy goes, that a value inside a location or inside a drawer can change, either if Dumbo brings some input value and is asked to put that value in a location. So in that drawer, whatever is the old value gets destroyed. Alternately, due to the operations of arithmetic kind that we asked Mr. Dumbo to do, whenever Dumbo keeps the result in a designated drawer, the old value in that drawer goes away. All these concepts, without saying too much about it, are actually picturized by the people. We have achieved one more thing. We have achieved a subtle introduction to the syntax of C programming language in a slightly disturbed fashion. Let us look at this slide again. Use locations A comma B comma sum semicolon. Observe that instead of use locations, if I say int A comma B comma sum or float A comma B comma sum, this is exactly like a C programming instruction. The statement use locations these automatically tells people that no action is implied by this instruction. It merely tells Dumbo to put tags onto the memory drawers. This is roughly equivalent of saying that this is a declaration and not really part of an executable instruction. Look at the next three instructions. Or the next instruction says input A comma B. Later on, when we introduce C in greater greater A comma B, people can instantly relate to the input instruction. You don't even have to tell people that C in greater greater means this, provided you have told them that programming languages have very funny looking syntax. You may have to use symbols which we normally don't use, but that is because those people who designed this programming language designed these symbols and these syntax, and we are all required to follow it, because that is what the modern Dumbo Mr. Computer understands. This instruction sum is equal to A plus B is exactly like an assignment statement in C++. And again, output sum is an instruction which can be related by people very easily to C out, because that does sound like an output, and that is exactly what it does. You may think about adopting it or not adopting it. You may think of some other method of doing this, but I will tell you my experience has been that students are able to much easily understand what is happening inside a computer because they have made a mental model of the basic components and basic operations of a computer. I am preparing short video clips of this introduction, including detailed instructions for the banking cashier, which I just mentioned as a name. And this is what brings me to another important topic, which I had touched upon in one of the assignments before the face-to-face portion of the workshop began. That assignment involved the following. It actually had a video. That video contained explanation on how some statements may have to be conditionally executed. The example used was to find the maximum of two given numbers. And we said that normal step-by-step procedure which is executed sequentially will not work in that case. It was a small video clip of 8 minutes. The audio in that clip was in English. My idea is that if such short clips are made and if such videos are dubbed in Indian languages, then students, particularly during the first week of their interaction with us in our engineering colleges, and where they have maximum problems, if at all, on understanding our English, can find it very easy to understand these things if the same videos are also available dubbed in Telugu, Tamil, Malayalam, Hindi, Gujarati, Bengali, Kannada, etc., etc. And it is for this reason that I have given an assignment showing you the methodology developed by the group working under my colleague Professor Kannan Maudgalya of what they call spoken tutorials. And I had said that it is our desire to prepare such open source spoken tutorials for all lectures broken into small videos. They will be available in English as well as in multiple languages. I had requested whether participants are interested in doing this kind of exercise in Indian languages. Out of a large number of people who indicated in the first survey that they would be comfortable in one or more of the Indian languages, the optional assignment sadly was not done by many, but still it was not a small number. More than 300 people have actually given their voice, okay, given their voice. They have actually taken the trouble to follow the spoken tutorial methodology, and they have created transcripts, and many of them have uploaded their own voice reading that transcript. Of course, because of the methodology that is followed in spoken tutorials, some of the transcripts sound very artificial because they read line by line, almost like a radio commentator and so on. There are several others, on the other hand, which where you can see the passion of the teacher in the voice that you hear. I have read almost all transcripts and I have heard most of them. And it's a wonderful effort. Those of you who actually chose to do this optional exercise, my heartiest compliment and my many thanks. I would like to use this opportunity to show you small snippets. These are all 8 minute, 10 minute audio things. What I have done is I have chosen some 4 or 5 samples and I have taken small portions, 1 minute, 2 minute portions from each one. I have deliberately not chosen the best. I have also not chosen the worst. That is because when we make such attempts, generally our first efforts would be average. There are some of you who have actually taken a whole lot of trouble and have most probably practiced a couple of times before recording their final voice. I can guess that because I know the kind of trouble that people have to take. However, I assure you that after you practice doing this for some time, the subsequent things become very easy. I would like to show you a small video. It is on YouTube. We are ready to play this. Please note that you will all be familiar with the slides. So please ignore the slides. Just listen to the voice and try to see whether I have been able to correlate the timing of their voice with whatever is going on in the slide. You must appreciate that I know only Hindi and Marathi, and therefore the synchronization of voice clips of our colleagues in Malayalam, Tamil, Gujarati and Bengali are done by me only on the basis of speculation, on the basis of some, after all, symbol A, B and some, or symbol A, B and max are to be said to be A, B and max only, whether you are using Tamil, Malayalam, Bengali or Gujarati. So I have used that to try to sort of synchronize the voice with the slides. I may not have succeeded, but this is just to show you how easy it is to put these audio dubbed voices onto the original video clip that is made at one place. Let's start.
Instruction de sequential execution mudal thodangam. രണ്ട് സംഖ്യകൾ എയും ബിയും തമ്മിൽ കൂട്ടാനുള്ള പ്രോഗ്രാം എഴുതിയിരുന്നു. മൂന്ന് ലൊക്കേഷൻസ് നിർവചിക്കുന്നതിനൊപ്പം എയുടെയും ബിയുടെയും മൂല്യം റീഡ് ചെയ്യാനുള്ള ഇൻപുട്ട് ഇൻസ്ട്രക്ഷനും എയും ബിയും തമ്മിൽ കൂട്ടി സമ്മിലേക്ക് നീക്കി വയ്ക്കാനുള്ള അസൈൻമെൻറ്റ് ഓപ്പറേഷനും സമ്മിലെ മൂല്യം പ്രദർശിപ്പിക്കാനുള്ള സി ഔട്ട് സം എന്ന ഓപ്പറേഷനും നമുക്ക് തന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇവിടെ തന്നിരിക്കുന്ന ഇൻസ്ട്രക്ഷൻസ് എല്ലാം ക്രമമനുസരിച്ച് ഓരോന്നായിട്ടാണ് എക്സിക്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. ചില സന്ദർഭത്തിൽ ചില കണ്ടീഷൻസ് അനുസരിച്ചാകും ഇൻസ്ട്രക്ഷൻസ് നാം എക്സിക്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. യഥാർത്ഥ ജീവിത സാഹചര്യത്തിൽ ഇത് പലപ്പോഴും സംഭവിക്കുന്നു. രണ്ട് അക്കങ്ങളിലെ വലിയ അക്കം കണ്ടുപിടിക്കാനുള്ള ചോദ്യം. ഇവിടെ നമ്മൾ രണ്ട് അക്കങ്ങൾ അതായത് എയും ബിയും തമ്മിൽ കൂട്ടാനല്ല, മറിച്ച് ഈ രണ്ടക്കങ്ങളിലെ വലിയ അക്കം കണ്ടുപിടിച്ച് മാക്സ് എന്ന ലൊക്കേഷനിലേക്ക് അസൈൻ ചെയ്യാനാണ് ശ്രമിക്കുന്നത്. ഈ പ്രോഗ്രാം തുടങ്ങുമ്പോൾ ആദ്യം നാം മൂന്ന് ലൊക്കേഷൻസ് നിർവചിക്കും. അതിനുശേഷം എയുടെയും ബിയുടെയും മൂല്യം റീഡ് ചെയ്യാനുള്ള ഇൻപുട്ട് ഇൻസ്ട്രക്ഷനും എഴുതും. ഇനി എയുടെയും ബിയുടെയും മൂല്യത്തിൽ ഏതാണോ വലുത് അതിനെ മാക്സിലേക്ക് അസൈൻ ചെയ്യും. എന്നാൽ ഇപ്പോൾ ഇത് എങ്ങനെ ചെയ്യണം എന്ന് നമുക്ക് അറിഞ്ഞുകൂടാത്തത് കൊണ്ട് തൽക്കാലം ഒരു റെക്ടാംഗുലർ ബോക്സ് നാം പേപ്പറിൽ വയ്ക്കുന്നു. പിന്നീട് നാം അതിൽ എഴുതും. എന്നാൽ ശരിയായ മൂല്യം മാക്സിൽ അസൈൻ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ആ മൂല്യം നാം ഔട്ട്പുട്ട് ചെയ്യണം. അതുകൊണ്ട് നമുക്ക് ഔട്ട്പുട്ട് സ്റ്റേറ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് എഴുതാം. ഒന്നുകൂടെ നമ്മുടെ പ്രോഗ്രാം സ്റ്റേറ്റ്മെൻസിൻ്റെ എക്സിക്യൂഷൻ ക്രമം നോക്കുക. ഇത് ഡിക്ലറേഷനാണ്. എയുടെയും ബിയുടെയും മൂല്യം റീഡ് ചെയ്യാനുള്ള ഇൻപുട്ട് സ്റ്റേറ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് നമുക്കുണ്ട്. എയുടെ മൂല്യമാണോ ബിയുടെ മൂല്യമാണോ മാക്സിലേക്ക് അസൈൻ ചെയ്യേണ്ടത് എന്ന് തീരുമാനിക്കാനുള്ള ഒരു ബോക്സും ഉണ്ട്. അവസാനമായി നാം ഇപ്പോഴുള്ള മാക്സിൻ്റെ മൂല്യം ഔട്ട്പുട്ട് ചെയ്യും.
ત્રણ સ્થળો વ્યાખ્યાયિત કર્યા હતા કે જે એ અને બીની કિંમત બહારથી લે છે અને એનો સરવાળો કરીને કિંમત સમમાં આપે છે. અંતે આઉટપુટ ઓપરેશન સી આઉટ લેસ ધેન સમ કે જે સમની કિંમત દર્શાવે છે. જુઓ કે બધી સૂચનો અથવા નિવેદનો આપેલ અનુક્રમમાં એક પછી એક પાલન કરવામાં આવે છે. ઘણીવાર એવી સ્થિતિ હોય છે
एक आयताकार बॉक्स जो कार्रवाई को निर्देशित करता है कि विपरीत एक हीराकार बॉक्स में एक इनपुट पास और दो आउटपुट पास होते हैं. हीराकार बॉक्स के अंदर हम कंडीशनल स्टेटमेंट को लिखेंगे. जब हम इस शर्त पर आते हैं तो यह शर्त ये इवेल्युएट होगा और अगर ये सही है तो एक पास पर ले जाएगा. उस पास में लिखा गया कथन सपोज एस वन निष्पादित होगा. दूसरे पास पर अगर शर्त गलत होगी यानी शर्त सही नहीं है तो हीरा आकार बॉक्स हमें अन्य पाथ पर ले जाएगा और एक अन्य कथन मानो एस टू निष्पादित होगा. उसके बाद हर केस में प्रोग्राम क्रमिक रूप से निष्पादित होगा. इतना है कि इस बिंदु के बाद कथन दिए गए अनुक्रम में ही निष्पादित होंगे.
আবার যদি আমরা আমাদের প্রোগ্রামের সিকোয়েন্স অফ এক্সিকিউশন দেখি তবে এটা অবশ্যই একটা ডিক্লারেশন স্টেটমেন্ট. এটা ইনপুট স্টেটমেন্ট যার দ্বারা ইউজারের থেকে এ ও বি এর মান নেওয়া যাবে. এই বক্সে সেই স্টেটমেন্ট থাকবে যার দ্বারা আমরা বুঝতে পারবো ম্যাক্সে এ ও বি এর মধ্যে কার মান অ্যাসাইন হবে. সবশেষে ম্যাক্সের মানের আউটপুট. এখন প্রশ্ন হলো এ ও বি এর মধ্যে কার মান ম্যাক্সে অ্যাসাইন হবে.
உங்கள் அனைவரையும் நிபந்தனை வாக்கியங்களை நமது நிரலில் செயல்படுத்துவது பற்றிய அமர்வுக்கு வரவேற்கிறேன். நாம் இன்னொரு முறை வரிசையாக கட்டளைகளை செயல்படுத்துவதில் இருந்து துவங்குவோம். நாம் எழுதிய கொடுக்கப்பட்ட இரண்டு எண்களை கூட்டும் நிரலை நினைவு கூறவும். நாம் கொடுத்த கட்டளைகள் மூலமாக மூன்று இருப்பிடங்கள் நியமிக்கப்பட்டு பின் ஏ மற்றும் பியின் மதிப்புகள் பெறப்பட்டன. பின் நிர்ணய கட்டளையினால் ஏ மற்றும் பி இன் மதிப்புகள் கூட்டப்பட்டு சம்மில் இடப்பட்டது. முடிவில் வெளியீட்டு செயல் சி அவுட் சம் மூலமாக சம்மானது வெளியிடப்பட்டது. இங்கு நமது எல்லா சொற்றொடர்களின் கட்டளைகளும் ஒன்றன் பின் ஒன்றாக தரப்பட்ட வரிசையில் செயல்படுத்தப்பட்டதை கவனியுங்கள்.
Well, I hope you are able to appreciate both the efforts made by our friends and what I showed you is just sample of five people practically arbitrarily chosen. Of course, it was not arbitrary because as I said, I didn't want to show only the best effort, I didn't want to show the worst effort, but I wanted to show some efforts in which at least those people who understand that language can decipher both the nice points and some inadequacy. For example, as I said, some of the voices, while the voices are very clear, very good, but the description is more in terms of, as I said, a radio announcer kind of thing. In some cases, the voice has lot of noise around it or breaks and things like that. In some cases, the things are not synchronized. In fact, I got several audio files which were either only 5 minutes when the original video was 8 minutes long, or they were even 12 minute audio. So people were so excited that they explained in their own manner. The correct way of doing it is actually play the video by muting the sound and then record while the video is playing so that your voice is exactly synchronized second to second, minute to minute. Of course, it is not easy. We are not, after all, movie artists with expertise in dubbing. But the idea is that we do not need an extraordinary expertise. Of course, we use that expertise. Our videos in multiple languages will look like National Geographic videos. While that will be ideal, it is not essential. Simple videos made by us alone at home in our offices may be adequate. I would now like to use the remaining time of this session to go over to other centers. Let's go to Terana Engineering College, Nehru.
Sir, good morning, sir. Since 2 days we are trying to just get connected to IIT. It's really a pleasure to talk to you, sir. My question is, sir, there is a confusion. Project should be on the topic assigned to us or on the entire C syllabus or C++ syllabus?
I think my instructions earlier also were very clear. Project cannot be on any one topic. A project is an activity which students do to build a programming system, small or big. And that programming system is built to solve a problem. And of course, to solve any real life problem in your programs, you will have to have conditional statements, you will have to have iterations, you might have objects, you might have functions, you will have all kinds of things. So, I wonder why this doubt has come, but it is quite possible that others should also have this doubt. So, I am clarifying, the project has absolutely nothing to do with the topic that has been allocated to your team. The topic is allocated only for you and your colleagues in the team to construct 3 quiz questions with answers and to construct an examination question with the model answer. That is the limited purpose of that topic. The project conceptualization, project description is meant to be an activity which would be done by student teams and which will attempt to solve a larger problem as I explained yesterday. I hope that answers your question. Thank you. Let's go to SVP Engineering College.
Sir, we have a question. Our student has developed an auto grader which can grade only one program based on whether the answer is correct. So on the discussions we had in the previous class, that the program can be the auto grader can analyze the program. So how it can be?
Oh, it would require a long answer, at least half an hour of discussion. There are some of my MTech students who are working on these things. Please ask that student to send a mail to me, but I will not recognize that student. So please ask the student to give your reference the reference to this workshop and send a mail to me. I will forward it to my MTech students, and in fact, if something good comes out of it, and if the student is willing to release that autograder in open source, we'll help him do that, so that the student and your center or your college would get some good name and publicity, and we may get some useful software. But there is a lot of work that is required. Initial attempt must be good, of course. I will definitely direct that student to the my MTech group here. Right.
We have done it like the students will upload their programs, and it will be automatically compiled and executed. And based on the answer we are getting, we will be evaluating whether that is correct or not.
Yes, that is exactly the essence of most autograders. In fact, there have been several such autograders also in IIT Bombay, which have been developed by various people, including faculty. But what I said is, we require two or three things more. We require the autograder to have the ability to partially grade answers, and for which the question has to be framed accordingly. And if we have framed the question accordingly, then the autograder has to be modified to be able to examine by running individual segments in consonance with the correct backend answer. That extension conceptually is not very difficult, but it takes time to implement. The second problem with autograders is that they must scale. For example, if I have a class of 300 students and all 300 students have submitted that assignment within the span of half an hour, ideally, the moment I as a student submit the assignment, meaning I type in, say, return, then within a few seconds, I should get my marks. Invariably, such efforts as have been taken by your student, for example, and we have several such efforts here, they do not scale. They will work in sort of sequence. So if you throw 300 programs at them one after another, each one may take only 2 seconds, but the 300th program will come out of 600 seconds. So that is another problem of scaling. It requires you to actually define an architecture where copies of the autograder will be executing in multiple virtual machines, and they would all be taking inputs from a queue, and the queue formation software will have to be written. So there are fairly complicated activities that you have to do. Actually, it would be a good project for students to do as a preliminary effort. But do write to us. We will try and see what we can do. At least it would be a good example for our own students who are working here. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Sir, we have mentioned that in code blocks, as whenever we are developing one project, we have to add programs. Programs will be added to the project. And how to compile the project? How to compile the programs individually?
Yes. As I told you, a group of my staff members are actually working on what they call a simplified code block, in which you don't have to develop a project or any such thing. That simplified version is able to take program files from a directory directly, compile and execute it. So you can have separate directories, and within the directories you can have separate source code files, and it is capable of just taking that file and executing it standalone. You don't need a project for it. So that simplified version might be easier for people to use in first 2 or 3 weeks, or 4 weeks, even 5 weeks, till such time that they need the additional features of debugging and so on. The version is almost ready. I think they have tested it on Ubuntu. They are testing it on Microsoft now, and we'll release it on the Moodle. I mean, we'll give you a link. Fortunately, the size of that package is only 20 MB, as opposed to 190 or 200 MB of the original package. And that is because our teams have removed all other non-essential paraphernalia from the package, such as compilers for other languages and whatever, whatever. You will hear about it very soon. Yeah. Om Institute of Technology.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
I have two questions. In the software engineering, what SDLC model should be best suited for the duration of 2 months project?
It is very difficult to formally state a particular model at that level. Please understand that even when we teach software engineering in second year, second semester, or third year, first or second semester, or even fourth year, even by that time, the students have not written any large amount of code. And to understand and appreciate these various approaches, you should actually have handled, I'm not saying written, but you should have handled programming systems having at least 25,000-30,000 lines of code. In fact, software engineering is better understood only by professionals who actually spent a year, year and a half, okay, in dealing with such large code. So what is the objective here? The objective here is not to teach them the software engineering approach of formal design or formal analysis, okay? I mean, if you do that, then your course will not be on basic programming, but the course will become a course on software engineering. That is not the intention at all. My suggestion to you is that you do tell them about what software engineering is, but stop there, absolutely stop there. And let them figure out how they should approach the problem. Some of them will be interested. They will read, for example, Pressman's book and try to follow it. What is important is two or three things that they should do. One, they should first write some functional description before they start coding. That's a very fundamentally important habit of software engineering. That they will do because our submission of the project is in those stages. That they will have to give a functional description first, then they will have to give a design description. Second, they should understand the importance of testing. Many students believe that once their program compiles properly and once it executes on one set of values, the job is done. The fact that individual programs require testing and combination of programs in order to work together require testing is another important point that you can drive home through the project. My request to you is that tell them about the software engineering principles, but don't tell them that what they are doing is actually a software engineering practice. Let them discover that automatically. Let them then do the normal programming, documentation and testing in that style. So the moment you talk about SDLC or any such thing, they will get scared and they will forget the more important part of understanding basic programming properly. That is my suggestion. This is Goa College of Engineering. Yes, I can see you, my friends from Goa College of Engineering. Over to you.
My name is Melina Maria Fonso. We have been eagerly waiting to hear you. So my question is, many times it has been noticed that the students who come from plus two, that is 11th and 12th, they already, many of them have an introduction to the programming language. So does your, how is it possible to differentiate, first of all, in terms of teaching as well as in terms of grading for students who have come with a background of programming while those who have not? And secondly, does your college have any provision to cater to the such needs of students who have learnt this knowledge at some place and those who haven't? And sir, time and again you have mentioned that C, C++ is not a language, I would say, for, you know, to introduce programming. So could you have some suggestions about two, three languages which would be interesting for actually introducing this subject?
So let me answer your second question first. When I said that C, C++ were not designed as programming languages to be used for introductory programming, but let me add to it, it does not mean that C, C++ cannot be used effectively to teach the first course. These two are different statements. Secondly, if you consider which are the programming languages which have been designed to introduce programming, the names like Scratch and Logo come to my mind. Unfortunately, the high-end professionals such as engineering college students and teachers consider it beneath their dignity to use things like Logo and Scratch to introduce programming. The point is that we are teaching programming with two purposes. One, to introduce programming, and two, to develop adequate competence in our students such that they can solve computational problems in their own field. It is for this reason that Fortran programming used to be taught in engineering colleges for decades, and that is because at that point in time, almost all computational procedures were available only in Fortran. Many faculty members who taught finite elements, for example, in civil engineering, or who taught chemical simulation and so on, they extensively used Fortran programming and Fortran library. In fact, the best Fortran programmer in IIT Bombay amongst the faculty was not one from computer science. Although I am myself an accomplished programmer, the best programmer is my colleague, Professor Gaitonde, who had written literally tens of thousands of lines of code for his own work in mechanical engineering department. So it was natural that all departments wanted us to teach Fortran programming there. Since then, the majority of computational procedures which are available today in terms of libraries or whatever are in C and C++. And that is one of the reasons why in IIT Bombay we still teach C and C++. The fact that it is not ideal to be used as the first course in programming is a problem that we teachers have to solve. But that competence is considered essential by the fraternity of engineering disciplines. And that is because that is what the students use later. As the usage changes in the profession, so will change the demand to use a specific programming language. What is important for us is to ensure that students learn programming concepts well. Once they learn programming concepts well, they can master any other programming language with reasonable ease. Our problem is the students get inundated in syntax and they confuse that knowledge of programming is same as knowledge of syntax properly. And many of us make the mistake by actually asking questions in our quizzes and tests which revolve around syntax and not around the logic of the program. So that is my long answer to a short question. C, C++ is perfectly adequate. And the very fact that our students become good programmers now, as they became good programmers 10 years ago when Fortran was being taught, and as they will become good programmers elsewhere if they start learning with Python or something. I am convinced that what programming language you use, while it is relevant, it is not the most critical part. The most critical part is our ability to actually teach the students and make them experts in proper thinking, in translating the algorithm into the program, as Professor Ranade said. So please look at that point. Don't be depressed by C and C++. It's perfectly all right. The JP Institute of Technology, yes. JP Institute, over to you.
Good morning, sir. Sir, myself, Shelly from JIIT Noida. Sir, I would request to, if you can please let us know the tools you used for creating the animation of Mr. Dumbo.
Yes. The tool that we use is another open source tool which is called Blender. Blender, is, you might have heard of professional animation tools which, for example, are taught in well-known institutions such as Maya Academy and all. These are costly tools. They are very good tools, of course, professional tools. But very little is known about Blender. Blender is an open source tool. It can do 2D and 3D animations well. It has a gaming engine. It can actually do versatile animation, including interactive animation and so on. We have a team actually which has created expertise. In fact, I had suggested to them that they could create a video recorded course on animation using Blender. But I will tell you, if you are interested, just go to the Blender site. Type Blender in Google, you will go to the Blender site. You can download that software. It's open source. So you can start using it from day one. And you can actually create interesting animations using that. So if you like, I'm happy you like Mr. Buddhuram Dumbo. The animation was created using Blender. Arunai College of Engineering.
This is Satyakla from Arunai College of Engineering. I have two questions. One is, actually, yesterday we have discussed some sample program for string manipulation. In that, we are using the header file hash include IO stream, and we are using use namespace std. But that coding will not execute in Turbo C++. My question is there any common tool to support all this type of codings?
Okay, you're talking about a tool, but it's not actually the tool, it is actually the utility or the environment which determines what particular directives will work and what particular directives will not work. What you are talking about are compiler directives and operating system directives. So for example, in Turbo C, most probably you have to use header files of the classical vintage, such as strings.h or such as stdio.h, whereas in the modern operating system environments, you might have to use something called C string and whatever. So this is not related to the programming language per se, but this is related to how the different environments expect the nomenclature of their header files to be made. I would suggest that you should advise students not to get too worked up. With a little experiment, they can immediately figure out that if a program runs in Unix with certain header files, a program will run in Turbo with certain other header file. On the other hand, there are a few things which Turbo environment does, but which Unix environment cannot easily do at all. For example, capturing raw input when you type a single character is done in Turbo environment so very easily and naturally. Whereas in the GCC compiler environment, when you want to input a character, you have to actually press return after that character, without which that character is not taken in. So these are some of the nuances, but don't worry. One thing is you can definitely tell people, there is nothing like a single tool which will universally accept everything and run it properly. In fact, I will remind you that only yesterday we saw through a question from one of our colleague participants that the sizes of memory variables are significantly different. They are not 4 bytes, but they are 2 bytes. This is another lacuna where the programming language itself says that the size of a variable is an implementation dependent thing. It merely, the language specification merely says that every implementation must be able to represent, let's say, numerical values in this range. But beyond that, it is silent about how the implementation is. So do not worry. These are the problems that will have to continue to sort of sort out. But these are not very insurmountable problems. We'll just take 2 more centers. We'll go to National Institute of Technology, Kurukshetra.
Good morning, sir. My question is that whenever we acquire PhD degree, or some person has acquired PhD degree, he is not a ready-made teacher. So basically, there should be some training program for those teachers who are just joining this profession.
What you just said is what I have been saying for about 30 years of my 45 years of experience. You're very right, you have touched the raw nerve. In every other profession, whether TCS employs an engineer or whether Tata Locomotives employ an engineer, they provide a training ranging from 3 months to 6 months before the person becomes a true professional. Teaching is unfortunately the only profession in which we are employed and we are told from tomorrow start teaching this course. I have been insisting that there has to be a mandatory training program for all teachers before they are even employed full-fledged. Let us hope, I have been making representations to the government, and let's hope that they make this training compulsory. Further, the training once is not adequate, because our job is a job which deals with changing knowledge every day. And that is why a minimum annual reorientation program on the subjects that we teach is very, very essential. The QIP programs, the AICT workshops, such as this IST workshop, etc., were designed for that, but they are apparently not adequate. So you are very right, I can only agree with you. Shulini University, Solan, is Himachal Pradesh.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Question is it possible to read string by string from a file in C programming? Generally, we read character by character. Thank you.
It is not string by string, but you can read line by line. If you recall, I had mentioned a function called gate S, which has been deprecated. It is no more a proper function, but a function called gate line will read one line. So you can read one line at a time as far as text files are concerned, separated by a line field or a new line character or carriage return. In that line, whatever characters you type, including blanks, including question marks, including whatever, all will be taken in as an input. You have to define a large enough array inside. In fact, there is no limitation. You can actually type maybe 1,000 characters in a row, one after another, before you press return. And all 1,000 characters, independent of how many blanks or whatever it is, so it is essentially a very, very big string, as long as your target array is large enough. So I hope that clarifies. In fact, one of the sample programs, the gate S statement has been used, which now should be replaced by gate line. We will have a tea break.